Welcome once again to Lehto's Law. Here's Steve Lehto.
Several people tipped me off to a story happening in Michigan, the thumb of Michigan. And Michigan's lower peninsula is shaped like a mitten. And over here is the thumb. And for instance, there's a town there called Bad Axe, where I worked as a disc jockey for a couple of years. But there's also a place called Greenleaf Township up there, who the headline says, must pay $140,000 in legal fees on a $500 verdict. They got hit for $500 at trial on a case where the law says if you lose, you have to pay the other side's attorney fees. It does not happen all the time in America. In America, if you sue somebody just on a typical lawsuit, breach of contract, negligence, that kind of thing, you have to pay your own attorney fees whether you win or lose. But some statutes have what they call fee shifting in them, so that if you sue somebody and you win under that statute, they have to pay your attorney fees. And that's what happened here. So the story is from Channel 62 out of Detroit. Detroit.cbslocal.com. David, Elliot, and Steve, not me, all sent it to me. Sarah Powers wrote the story. A tiny community in Michigan's thumb region has a large legal bill. Greenleaf Township, population 740, must pay roughly $140,000 in legal fees to a resident who won a $500 verdict under a law in Michigan called the Michigan Open Meetings Law. The Open Meetings Law. And that law requires the local municipality to conduct its business in public. So, you know, there's meetings. You can go watch the city council or the township council or whatever they call themselves. You can go watch them conduct business for the most part. Not everything they do is public, but most of it winds up being public. So they've got to pay that money now after they lost this lawsuit. So the Open Meetings Act, I'm going to give you the brief description here, requires public bodies to conduct business at open meetings. The act applies to any local governing body, including a board, a commission, a committee, a subcommittee, or an authority. The act sets forth regulations for public meetings that include notification, public participation, rules for holding closed meetings, and the legal requirements for meeting minutes. The minutes must be available also. So if you violate that, someone can come after you for it, and that's what happened. So here, the $500 verdict wouldn't be that bad. It's the $140,000 in legal fees they got to pay, because that's more than the township's annual budget, according to Judy Keller, who is the Greenleaf clerk. The township argued in court that the fees were excessive when compared to the small amount awarded to the woman who brought the lawsuit. But the court noted that the state law grants actual legal fees to the winning side in a claim and not reasonable fees. And the question is, are those different? Actual versus reasonable. We'll discuss that. So the 6th U.S. Circuit Court of Appeals said recently that even though the attorney fee award is gargantuan compared to the outcome of the case, we thus must affirm the award. They affirmed the award. There are two people who consider themselves watchdogs in the Sanilac County Township sued Greenleaf officials over the open meetings violations, as well as First Amendment retaliation and other allegations. A jury in 2018 awarded $500 to one of the women on the open meetings claim. $500. U.S. District Judge Mark Goldsmith said time spent on the case by her attorneys was rooted in the open meetings dispute, even if some of it was technically related to non-meeting claims. So Judge Goldsmith, by the way, at one point in time was a judge in Oakland County. And I've appeared before him, so he's a very good judge. I know that personally. But the point here is that the statute says, here's what you must do if you are a municipality, for instance. You must have these meetings open for these reasons and this time, blah, blah, blah. It's things you got to do. If you break that, someone can come by and go to court and say, you violated that law. You got to pay damages and attorney fees. And so what happens in a lot of these cases with fee shifting sections in them is that the defendants don't understand how ugly it can get when they go to court and lose. And I've had cases before where I was awarded more in attorney fees than my client got from a jury. It happens. And I've spoken to attorneys early in litigation and said, look, you understand that when you guys lose, your client's got to pay you for all the work you did. Then they got to pay me for all the work I do, plus they got to pay whatever the jury gives us. And I've had attorneys go, huh, it's never going to happen. Later on, I'm talking to them out in the hallway going, I told you. And I've had attorneys actually say, well, my client's okay with that. My client's okay. They wanted to prove a point. Fine, cut me a check. Prove your point. So I'm going to tell you right now that the two statutes I'm most familiar with that have fee shifting in them are the Lemon Law, which is a state law, and the Magnuson-Moss Warranty Act, which is a federal law. And they both approach this kind of differently, but it's something that, you know, people should be aware of, is how these attorney fees are calculated. What do we determine as a reasonable attorney fee? So, for instance, Michigan's Lemon Law says a consumer who prevails in an action brought under this act may be allowed by the court to recover as part of the judgment a sum equal to the aggregate amount of costs and expenses, including attorney's fees, based on actual time expended by the attorney, determined by the court to have been reasonably incurred by the consumer for or in connection with the commencement and prosecution of such action, unless the court, in its discretion, shall determine that such an award of attorney fees would be inappropriate. So the court will give them unless there's some reason it would not be appropriate. But it sounds like you're going to get them if you win. Now, it does say they may be allowed. And the question is, when they say may be allowed, does that mean a court could just willy-nilly say, nah, you don't get them? There's too much language after that that implies that you should get them. So, for instance, it says a sum equal to the aggregate amount of costs and expenses, including attorney's fees based on actual time expended by the attorney, determined to have been reasonably incurred. So if you reasonably incurred these expenses, you're going to get them back. If you win, if you lose, you don't get them back. That's a problem. Now, many states have got rules and methods for calculating what a reasonable attorney fee is. So let's suppose you just had a case where it just says you'll get your attorney fees if you prevail. The question is, what are your attorney fees? Obviously, you can't steal my attorney. He charges $1 billion an hour, and he put 1,000 hours in the file. Pay him. So under state law in Michigan, there are the Michigan Rules of Professional Conduct that actually describe 8 factors for determining what's a reasonable attorney fee. For instance, the time and labor required, how many hours were put into the file, the novelty and difficulty of the questions involved, the skill requisite to perform the legal service properly, the fee customarily charged in the locality for similar legal services, the amount involved and the results obtained, the time limitations imposed by the client, the nature and length of the professional relationship with the client, the experience, reputation, and ability of the lawyer or lawyers performing the services, whether the fee is fixed or contingent. And there's these factors they look at. And so if you file a case and you win, and you're going to have a fee hearing, the judge in state court is going to go through all of these factors and go through them one by one and ask you to explain how that applies to your fee. And the other side, of course, gets to object to all this and argue and try to muddy the water as much as they can. But it basically boils down to, you know, how much work did you do? Was it reasonable? And you're going to get paid. I've actually testified at a hearing where I was getting my own attorney fees paid. I've also testified as an expert on someone else's attorney fees and whether or not those are reasonable. And so there's a lot of factors involved, but unfortunately, like I said, it gets ugly if you're the defendant. You got to pay these. So a judge will figure out what a reasonable fee is and award it. And don't get me wrong, I've seen attorneys who win a case and start claiming all kinds of insane things. I have some very good attorney friends who do defense work, and they'll call me and say, Steve, I just got a fee request. It's insane. And if you actually look at some of these billing sheets, they would imply that they're at the office 24 hours a day doing nothing but working on this file. So judges do get angry when they see that. I've seen judges actually criticize attorneys for doing that. Meanwhile, in the federal system, there's federal statutes and federal courts. And so a good federal statute is the Magnuson-Moss Warranty Act, which is another law I'm very familiar with. There it says if a consumer finally prevails in any action brought under this act, he may be allowed by the court to recover as part of the judgment a sum equal to the aggregate amount of costs and expenses determined by the court to have been reasonably incurred by the plaintiff for or in connection with the commencement and prosecution of such action, unless the court in its discretion shall determine that such an award would be inappropriate. So it's basically, you know, reasonable, you know, fees, but it does say he may be allowed. But this is the interesting thing. May, generally speaking, means that you might get it, you might not get it. So there's a permissive portion there, right, in the interpretation of it. However, I actually found that, and while I was reading up on this, I came across this language. Although may allow has a permissive ring to it, the Supreme Court has read this as mandatory, where the plaintiff prevails and special circumstances are absent. So a lot of statutes refer to them as remedial statutes. They're there to remedy a problem or fix a problem. If a statute is remedial, it should be read or interpreted in such a way as to help remedy the problem it's trying to fix. So if a consumer has been harmed by the failure of a warranty and files a lawsuit under the Magnuson-Moss Warranty Act and prevails, it makes sense that you want to encourage that because that's what the law is designed to do. So if you didn't pay the attorney fees on those cases where consumers win, no attorney would ever take these cases, and most consumers couldn't afford to pursue them. So it's actually considered to be not so permissive as mandatory unless there's special circumstances. So let's suppose, I'm going to make something up here. Let's suppose I've got a slam dunk Magnuson-Moss Warranty Act claim, and I filed a lawsuit, and the attorneys offer to settle it immediately. These defendants go, we'll sell the case right now. I say, no, I'd rather run up my fees. There are other ways you can stop this, but I'm just giving you a crazy example. And if they came into court and said, Your Honor, we offered to settle this guy day one, and his attorney fees would have been de minimis compared to what he wants now with his gargantuan award, a judge might say, well, why did you do that? Why didn't you settle it early on? So, you know, the attorneys aren't there to run up their fees. The attorneys are there to help their clients. And if they incur fees along the way that are reimbursable, that's fine. But if it looks like they're spinning their wheels on purpose, you know, trying to just get the odometer to roll, a judge won't play along with that. So getting back to the original case here, the allegation was that Greenleaf Township violated the Open Meetings Act. They violated the Open Meetings Act. And the statute explicitly says that if you think that you've been harmed by somebody violating this act, you can file an action and seek $500 in damages. You can seek $500 in damages. So the defendants in this case apparently fought this and took it all the way up to the U.S. Sixth Circuit Court of Appeals and lost. And that's not a cheap trip. That's an expensive trip to take. So going into that, somebody should have looked at this and said, how can we settle this? Because we're fighting a $500 claim and they're running up six figures in attorney fees. And guess what? The township's probably spending money too. It's probably costing them money. This litigation ain't cheap on either side, you know? So it's a crazy story, but this stuff can happen. And in the old days, you often used to hear about this too, where there's been some changes on this. But in the old days, when somebody would claim a violation, like say a 1983 violation, a civil rights violation, they'd go in front of a jury. And when they realized they weren't going to get a big award, they'd often say, just give us a dollar to prove a point. Without telling the jury, by the way, in the old days, if you got $1, you could then get your attorney fees paid. Because the statute said you get your damages and attorney fees if you prevail. And they've actually spun it around a little bit with the case law. Courts have said, you know something, that's not what the law was intended to do. The law was intended to remedy actual problems. And this bit about give us a dollar to prove a point stuff doesn't mean you're necessarily going to get your attorney fees because you proved a point. You have to prevail, and you have to prevail in a way that's meaningful or substantial. So not going to get into that here. Here, the $500 verdict is exactly what the statute says. You win, you get $500 plus your attorney fees. And the question is, what's your actual attorney fees? And it turns out it's $140,000. So you get those now also. The question is, how does Greenleaf Township scrape up that money when they've only got 740 people in their entire population? And the amount they've been awarded, or the amount they've been ordered to pay to the other side, is more than their annual budget. Crazy story, but thanks for sending it, David, Elliot, and Steve. Channel62detroit.cbslocal.com. Sarah Powers wrote it. This township in Michigan must pay $140,000 in legal fees on a $500 verdict. Questions or comments, put them below. I'll talk to you later. Bye-bye.
Thank you for watching Lehto's Law. You are allowed to be a masterpiece and a work in progress at the same time.